moving interest rates and other market factors. But if you wouldn't mind, I would like to not comment this morning.
Secretary Kemp, do you wish to comment on this? I know.
Well,
you could affect the markets.
The gentleman knows how much I'd like to comment and can't. No.
You might want to ask the secretary to comment on the impact of pyrrhea on home building, because he was down at the home builders convention also.
Would you comment on that, John?
Carol, having just returned from the home builders convention, having talked to many of the people. Now, were you there?
Yes, I was.
Yeah, and I'm sure you got much of the same message as did Mr. Wiley, and certainly the president when he was down there. And for the record, the president, I was in the hall with the president on the dais, and he did not, I repeat, did not call for lower interest rates. He wasn't putting, in my view, any pressure on the chairman. He was suggesting that it was his opinion that there was room for lower long-term interest rates, but it was not my impression that he in any way was suggesting that the Fed ought to flood the marketplace with dollars and hope to push down short-term rates in some, which would be counterproductive, because it would have a negative impact on long-term interest rates, weaken the dollar, and probably send interest rates up. I'm not speaking for the president, but someone suggested earlier that he might have been trying to make political hay, as Chairman Greenspan said.
Could I ask Mr. Carney one question?
But I would like to just say, Carol, that there is deep concern, as you found in Atlanta, among builders on the finding the financing for housing construction. FIREA was not intended to cut production, and I think there are some unintended consequences to the loans to one borrower provisions, as was pointed out, as well as the risk-based capital standards. And my hope is that we can find ways of partnering with Freddie and Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae, to find the secondary markets, as well as the transition rules that would help the production of housing and construction of
quickly
multi
again,
as well as single family housing.
Thank you. Quickly to Mr. Carney, what is the pace of the resolutions of the thrifts? And also, if you would, if interest rates do go up, how do you think this will impact on RTC's ability to sell residential properties, especially under the affordable housing program, which does not allow subsidies?
With respect to the pace of resolutions, as I mentioned to Mr. Leach, I think given the constraints that the RTC has faced, it has been quite acceptable. I think it's important to note that we've made two rather dramatic changes in the way thrift institutions have been resolved. One is that what well-publicized availability of these institutions is now the order of the day. Heretofore, institutions were resolved by contacting people who had expressed some interest in acquiring a thrift. Now these institutions are advertised in the Wall Street Journal and the Federal Register, so that a lot of people who might be interested in entering the industry can bid on them. And I might say in several instances we've had so many bidders that it has elongated the due diligence process. So I think that, as I said, I think that that is been quite acceptable progress on the part of the RTC. With respect to the question of interest rates, obviously higher interest rates will impact the value of the real estate. It's capitalization rates are really a function of interest rates. And however, I should note that since October, we've actually had somewhat lower interest rates, so that we've had, that's a favorable development for our valuations.
The time of the gentleman has expired. Ms. Rockenlund?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I do appreciate the testimony here today. I'll just observe that Mr. Kemp has already touched on the question of the affordable housing and the right for first review, not really first refusal, right for first review. I think that is concern for a number of us, and I appreciate your comments on that, and this will be an ongoing discussion, I assume. And the question of loans to one borrower, I think, and the housing industry's concerns have been adequately covered. I express a caution. I understand what the builders are talking about, particularly the small builders, but we have to be careful if we're going to make it, some adjustment there. But my question now is more to Mr. Greenspan, and it's to the working capital question. Mr. Chairman, I don't think you've addressed yourself, at least not while I was in attendance, to that question about working capital and how we're going to account for it. I believe my colleague, Mr. Leach, made reference to his general agreement that maybe the Seidman proposal, or the one that seems to be most under consideration, tapping the Federal Finance Bank as a way to do that. I am concerned about how we go about gaining adequate working capital and how we account for it. And I think, Mr. Chairman, you are the one that I would most like to hear from on that subject, but of course I would invite commentary from any other members as well. But do you share my concern? It seems to me that we're a little adrift here, not only in terms of the amount of money that we need, but also how we're going to account for it.
First, let me say, Mrs. Brookman, that I subscribe to what Deputy Secretary Robson's I subscribe to his earlier remarks on this issue. First, I think it's important to recognize that in order to get the lowest cost to the taxpayer of what is a legal commitment to essentially resolve this particular issue, adequate working capital is essential. The recording of the difference between the $50 billion amounts and the working capital are actually readily, easily separated, essentially because in the financing of these institutions, losses are recorded, and the loss that is currently on the books at this point, as the Secretary pointed out, is $6.4 billion. That number is a charge against the $50 billion. Everything else that is out there, with the exception of administrative expenses of the RTC and the Oversight Board, is essentially working capital. It is capital that is used to facilitate the resolution of this problem. So I don't think there is an accounting problem that confronts us, but what we do need is working capital adequate to prevent any types of actions by the RTC which inadvertently increase the cost of the resolutions. I don't believe there is a problem of somehow or other creating additional monies for resolutions by increasing working capital, since the books are very clear on that question, and if we are properly audited and we properly focus on exactly what is a loss and what is not a loss, the line is very distinct. All monies that are truly working capital and are not in the loss category will ultimately flow back into the Treasury. And I might add that that issue is an issue which I think Mr. Schumer was raising early on, which is the accounting of that on the budget, which I think we have to be careful about. I am actually less concerned about the issue of the monies that are used for working capital increasing whatever published deficit we use, and the Federal Financing Bank, of course, would do that. I am more concerned about the other side of that. When these monies flow back into the Treasury, if they are on budget, they will be a reduction of the deficit, and they could very easily, granted the magnitude of what we are talking about, obscure our underlying problem. So above all, I think in the keeping of the books and the budgetary procedures, we have to be careful to whether we do it legally or otherwise, to keep this analytically off budget. Because unless we do that, we are going to get this process of just working capital monies, which are a rotating fund for which there is no loss to the Treasury or to the taxpayer, we'll let the flows of those monies obscure the very crucial aspects of budgetary restraint in this country.
By the argument of, Chris, I'll let Mr. Schumer speak for himself, question for himself, but the argument of the truth in budgeting accounting system, that's not the central issue as far as you're concerned.
No, it is not.
It is not. Thank you. I appreciate it. If Mr. Robeson has something to add, I do appreciate your response.
I did simply want to echo what Chairman Greenspan said, and that is the two issues are quite separate. That is, one is an accounting on the books of the RTC to make sure that the money that's devoted to paying the net losses of the resolved thrifts is separated from that money that is raised on a continuing basis for working capital. And I think Chairman Greenspan has given you the assurance that I would give you, and that is, I don't think it's an accounting difficulty. And indeed, if I remember correctly, the FERIA legislation calls for a statement of the loss of each thrift resolved. So I don't think that should be a problem.
Thank you. This is a helpful response. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Holker?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I never claimed to speak for Chairman Rostenkowski, but I think he'd probably disagree with that off-budget, on-budget analysis. But I was heartened to hear Chairman Greenspan and Secretary Kemp speak out favorably for thrift institutions and the need for them, and I think that is a good vote of confidence, particularly for those who have operated with integrity over a long period of time and the need to have them for our housing needs. Mr. Carney, there have been published stories concerning our RTC's early repayment of the $11.3 billion it lent to 169 thrifts under its control. Some analysis claimed that this early repayment will cause an increase in interest rates because these institutions will be forced to seek additional deposits. What's your response to this, and does this plan, do you agree with those analysis that claim that?
Well, first of all, we have not, and I don't believe the RTC has instituted any procedures for repayment of the $11.3 billion in high-cost fund replacement of the funds that we've dispersed so far. Perhaps there was a confusion with respect to the working capital facility, because once the working capital facility is up, we would envision those funds being replaced by the working capital facility so that we could account for dispersion of funds under FIREA as filling the hole as opposed to working capital.
I can't hear. Can you speak up? Could you speak?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Pull the mic up a little bit. So that's not accurate that you have dispersed.
I don't believe
that.
It is, no.
Okay. Well, then I'm looking on page 14 of Secretary Robeson's report, chart 1. Can you go through that for us? Because you made some statements as to what really are funds replacement and what really shouldn't be counted, what should be counted.
Yes.
And we're dealing with billions of dollars. I mean, either one of you, and I'm a little confused as to what you feel counts against the $50 billion and what doesn't.
Well, let's start with that. The number that...
Either one, it's fine. Page 14 of Secretary Robeson's report to us.
There was, if you see from that, $24.5 billion in a total. And if you look at the top line, net thrift losses, that is the amount that was applied to so-called fill the hole and is the amount that ought to be charged against the $50 billion. It is that covers the gap between the liabilities of an institution and its assets. And it is that to which the $50 billion is to be devoted. the other figures on that, the top part of the page, are for the value of assets purchased in case resolutions, and what that demonstrates there is that in order to buy the assets, in order to resell them, they must be, some money must be laid out up front in order to purchase those assets, hold them, and then dispose of them. And when those assets are sold, there should be $5.4 billion that returns to the pot. The high cost.
What's the time frame for that?
I'm sorry.
Return of the $5.4 billion. What's the time frame?
That will depend in every case on the alacrity with which they sell a particular asset. In some cases, it may be a short period of time if it's a marketable asset that's a desirable one. In other cases, if you have a hunk of land down somewhere where things are pretty soft, it may take a while.
Well, see, I think that's important because you have, Congresswoman Rockema had asked you the question I was thinking of asking you relative to you saying that we don't have enough and you think we're going to need more to the $50 billion fund source. But if you get a return on that $5.4 billion, I mean, it looks as if I just read this, I would think you would spend half of it already. But the fact is you're saying that with the majority of you, you're going to get it back. But I think it's important for Congress, and I know the chairman has a concern about you're wanting more funds for this use, and I think it's important for us to know what your projections are, your timetables are.
Well, as I said earlier, and maybe Dan would like to add to this, for the year ahead of us, I think the Chairman Seidman is predicting somewhere in the $25 to $35 billion range for working capital needs. And as I said in my testimony, over the period of resolutions, 3 year period of resolutions here, you could see a peaking of working capital needs somewhere between $40 and $100 billion, and it's very hard to predict when that will occur or exactly how high, but it's going to be a peak and valley exercise as assets are sold and as assets are bought and as more thrifts are resolved. And as that pace picks up, then the working capital needs are likely to become a greater demand.
Well, I think that's a real key issue for our consideration. Just one last comment, and that is that I hope the Federal Housing Finance Board, which the Secretary is the only permanent member, really gets, you know, into a gear of action, since that's critical. And I also hope that some women and minorities are appointed to these boards. I think that's important for public perception and certainly in terms of talent as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Wehrreiter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And gentlemen, thank you very much for your testimony and for the energy and effort you're bringing to this crucially important task. I want to just concentrate on a couple of details. First, just a comment. I know that you've got a tremendous hiring task ahead of you to man the RTC, and it's understandable you have some problems. I've seen those problems. I think there's a lot of disarray. I know it's a short period of time to bring this in line, but I would hope that, for example, you might have some centralized information sharing and review process in place soon. The first question I have relates to a decision the RTC has made to give potential thrift buyers an opportunity to bid on various components of thrifts, in other words, individual branches. And I want to commend you for that decision. I believe it's implemented in a adjacent state.
Kansas City.
And I think in many instances that will be in the best interest of the communities and the state as well as the federal government. I just wonder if that will now be a routine consideration when you're selling or disposing of thrifts.
Dan Carney, maybe you'd like to answer
yes,
that.
Yes, it is. The that was what I referred to earlier, is in the changing of the procedures, we do not dictate the method of resolution, whether it be by purchase and assumption or whole thrift or branch sales. And indeed, in the Kansas situation, it was a branch sale, and it turned out to be more cost effective for the government than the other alternative resolution.
I'm glad to hear that, and I think it will often be the case. At least it should be an alternative given consideration from the beginning. The second and final point I wanted to come to is the matter of conflicts of interest. With Secretary Robson, you mentioned this on page 38 and following. Had some comments coming to us about that process. I believe your regulations will be online and probably in March, and you have final ones out. I think the review period is passed, as a matter of fact,
That's correct.
The 12th. Who will serve by category, by type of individual on the RTC's contract conflict resolution committee, and how will you select those people?
Dan, do you want to take that one?
The contracts compliance committee is a committee comprised of key personnel at the RTC and the FDIC. Those people will be selected by Chairman Seidman. And perhaps you should ask him that question tomorrow.
You're going to have a case-by-case determination, as I understand it. If someone can answer this, I'm not sure, based upon your last question. How do you think this committee will assure that the same kind of favoritism experienced in the award of contracts by the FSLIC and FADA won't occur again when you're dealing with an interpretation of Section 501. Anybody feel
well, we are incorporating in the draft regulations, which, as you point out, have been out for comment, and we've received some 60 comments with respect to those regulations, a broadly disseminated opportunity for the private sector to participate in the business of the RTC. What the Contract Compliance Committee is designed to do is to permit private contractors who feel that they have been not fairly dealt with to appeal to this Contracts Compliance Committee to assure that they get due process, if you will. So I believe that that openness of that process will perhaps preclude the kind of thing that you're referring to.
We certainly want to clean that up. There's a fine line, is I suppose, how many hoops one has to jump through, and if the appeal process is a timely process. And we'll watch to see how you implement that.
Mr. B. Ryder, will you yield to me at that point?
I'd be pleased to yield to you, Mr. Chairman.
I think you've touched on a very troubling. I was going to wait till we came back to the round robin, but I think this is a proper time. As I understand the under the promulgation of your rules, a contractor is ineligible to do business with the RTC if the contractor has caused, and I quote, a substantial loss to insured depository institutions. Substantial loss, in turn, is defined under the proposed ethics regulations as a loss of more than $50,000 represented by a final judgment. Under that rule, both Don Dixon Vernon and Charles Keaton could contract with RTC because there has been no final resolution, which means no appeal to the Supreme Court of the charges brought against him. I think this is very troubling, and I don't think I think that somebody there in the legal action section has a little job here to do to.
If I may comment, Mr. Chairman, I don't know the particulars of Mr. Dixon and the other gentleman that you referred to, but I will just say for the record that in addition to the cause of a loss, there is a prohibition against anyone who is engaged in unsafe and unsound banking practices. And should that be the thrust of your comment, on that ground, the individuals would not be permitted to contract.
Well, what I'm afraid of is that unless there's little refinement there, that you could face that possibility. I think that the rigidity of the language and the absolute definition as interpreted, if you were to get into a litigation would call for a little bit of elaboration on that.
I will undertake to look at that, Mr. Chairman, as we look at the comments that have been received from the public sector.
Thank you very much.
I appreciate your intervention. Thank you. No more questions. Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Vento.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that most of us, when this bill passed, were probably unrealistic in assuming that we're going to hit the ground running and we're going to be doing these resolutions immediately, especially after the action, the executive action to take over nearly 300 institutions and put them under the FDIC. I must say that I'm disappointed that we didn't do a little more. Are you, as a board, Mr. Robson, satisfied with the slow pace and the limited scope of the RTC resolutions?
Well, let me say this. I think that the pace of the resolutions in the startup mode that we've been in for the last 5 months has been reasonable. Frankly, I like to see it faster, and I think it's going to get faster, that's what this whole thing was created for.
I think that's right. I mean, we wanted to do more. I think everyone wanted to see it. And about the limited scope, I'm concerned that most of these transfers really have been deposit transfers, which really don't get rid of any of the assets. I mean, they don't get rid of any of the problem side of it. Where you've given the option to put the assets back, institutions have exercised that option almost to the number. So, I mean, these deposit type of sales are really not very difficult and really don't represent much of an accomplishment, do they?
Well,
even the limited 40 that we've done.
The whole bank deals, of course, are the ones where the assets go with the liabilities. Traditionally, those will take a longer time because the buyer will want to perform due diligence and such. And I think that the direction of the RTC has been to move in to that direction.
Well, isn't it true, Mr. Robson, and I guess Mr. Carney can chime in if he cares to, that one of the reasons you need working capital is because you have not. In other words, as longer you hold on to the institutions, that you're going to need working capital. If we were able to accelerate this, the need for working capital would be less. Isn't that correct?
The need for working capital, if you are buying assets and accelerate it, would be more. If you do more whole bank deals, obviously you would avoid working capital in those situations.
That's correct.
Yes.
So, I mean, it would be if we were doing whole bank transfers, of course, and selling the assets. Obviously, if you're going to back up the bad assets with cash and you were just doing deposit transfers, you'd need an awful lot. Well, that wouldn't be working capital. That would be filling the black hole, wouldn't it?
No, I
mean,
think
you still have to carry those bad assets on your books then, so you'd need working capital to function with them. My time is very brief, so let me just move ahead to another question. Mr. Seidman has said that we have a $40 to $100 billion need for working capital. I'm sure my euphemism wasn't lost in any of you, but let me ask you at this point, Mr. Carney, where does that figure come from? You're obviously repeating it. You're singing from the same song sheet here. Can you verify that figure for the committee today, the $40 to $100 billion need?
Well, the figure for $40 to $100 billion is a result of one's assumptions, A, how fast resolutions are done, B, the type of resolution, that is to say, if the acquirer doesn't take the assets.
Well, let me just stop. Pardon me for interrupting you, but have you verified that? I mean, I understand somewhat what the need is, but what I'm interested is, has the Oversight Board examined that figure in detail and verified it, or are we relying on just what Mr. Seidman says? I understand the basis, but I'm asking you if you verified that figure. We're talking
Fairly large range, and I would say that it's safe to assume that the working capital requirement will be between $40 and $100 billion.
But, I mean, have you verified that? How are you coming up with this particular number? I want to understand the genesis of it from your perspective as an Oversight Board in terms of the dollars spent. Have you verified it?
The cash flow projections were prepared by the RTC and given to us.
And so you're accepting them. You have no independent
yes,
view or analysis of that. In the In the document you presented to us, you indicate that the high cost fund replacement, 8.3, is working capital. In fact, do you expect to get that money back?
Some of it, yes. Yeah,
some
fact,
of it.
In fact,
what
well,
is what is the total cost of the institutions? The RTC now has disposed or resolved something like 40, but not all the assets. They're still back with the RTC. We've not done very much in assets. That is, we've done deposit transfers. I'm sure the board members understand that. The fact is that what is the total cost that they estimate now to deal with the resolutions of the 300 institutions and assets that remain?
What does the RTC estimate the total cost?
Well, I guess we're going on their estimates. I don't know if, I guess you're going on their estimates, of course.
I believe that the RTC's estimate for the institutions that have been resolved and those presently under conservatorship is in the order of $40 billion.
I thought heard it was 42. So in other words, there are, of course, the expectation that 200 additional institutions will be, at least 200 additional institutions, OTS, that will be transferred over. Is that correct?
Well, there are approximately 200 plus that have been identified, as Mr. Robson said in his testimony, as most likely by the Office of Thrift Supervision.
Of course, I think the strategic plan deals with a lot of details. One of them that is quite controversial is the financing, that is making loans to prospective buyers. And you have that in the statement. You want to comment about that? I know that at one point you said you didn't think it was a very good idea, but it's still in the plan. You know I don't think it's a very good idea.
Seller financing you're referring to?
Yes.
We have a seller financing provision in the plan which requires a 25% down payment and a first mortgage on any property, a real estate property that's transferred to sellers. The RTC has asked us to consider modifications to that policy for other types of assets, and
they want it to be more generous, I might add, Mr. Chairman, just so long as the committee
members correct.
Understand.
That is correct. They do want it to be more generous, and we have that under, we got a request for that last Friday, and we're looking at it.
My time, I guess, has expired.
Unfortunately, the gentleman's time has expired.
Could I add, Mr. Chairman, might I add one thing
certainly,
in response to Mr. Bento's question, and that is, our goal here is to try to get this job done and as quickly and responsibly as we can. And in some cases, we don't want to end up keeping the reins too tight so that they're not going to be able to do transactions. And what we've started out with is a very conservative approach, which I think will probably be the general theme of this oversight board. But there may be adjustments that we're going to make in some of these as we go along to find a little more flexibility.
Mr. Hyler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I've been absent for the better part of an hour and a half, so I'll not ask any questions, but I would make a very short observation.
Certainly.
And that's that I do not envy you gentlemen your job on the oversight board. Clearly, this is a we've come up with a piece of legislation that took the Congress 176 days from introduction until we passed it. I'm not saying that that was a long time or a short time. We utilized every day of that 176 days. Come up with a complicated piece of legislation that, frankly, I'm not sure anybody totally understands how all the pieces come together. I've been reading in some of the trade press recently how some of the different groups involved with housing are now who were supportive of the strict capital requirements last year are now concerned that as those capital requirements go in place for savings and loans, suddenly that means there's no loans going to some of the types of products that those industries were supplying, and now they'd like the Congress or in some way to try to relieve or have a phase-in period of time. I'm not saying that that's a bad idea or a good idea, but I think what it points out is that as each succeeding month goes along, more and more problems are going to come up as the interaction of the overall economy with the specifics of the bill come together to try to work this situation out. It seems to me that this will be the first of many, many, many oversight hearings on the oversight board and the activities you all are engaged in. I guess what I would encourage you to do, and I'm not saying that you haven't done this, but I would encourage you to do this in the future. The more and the quicker, the more information and the quicker that you can give us that information when, in your estimation, circumstances are changing that require us to relook at some of the assumptions that went into that legislation. When those things come up, the sooner you can tell us that, the better off we're all going to be in coming up with the fixes along the way to keep us on the course of resolving this problem. If we go another 3 or 4 years before we have major legislation to resolve some of the problems that crop up, we'll be right in the same fix we were in 1989. And I, for one, am not very excited about undergoing that process again. So I guess that's to empathize with your job, but also to ask you to let us know at the soonest instance when you think that circumstances are changing that would require some legislative change in the law. Otherwise, you know, 6 months or a year afterwards, when you should have come up, we'll have you up here and we'll be berating you and criticizing you and everything else for not having told us.
I don't think you'll find a speck of difference between your view of that and everyone on this board on that issue. As I said in my testimony, you know, when we don't know whether the $50 billion will ultimately prove to be enough, and if we come to the point where we think it isn't going to be, we'll tell you and come up here and ask you for some more. There may be other things along the way that prove to be obstacles to getting this job done, and we won't be timid about coming up and asking you to fix them.
Thank you. Yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Barnard?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, the strategic plan which you have enumerated today in your testimony, was that developed by the policy board or was that a product of the RTC?
It was the product, it was published and it's issued by the oversight board, Mr. Barnard, and it was, however, created in consultation with the RTC as well as I indicated earlier, response to public comments, the Housing and Urban Development Department, and the Federal Reserve.
From what I can see, I don't see any area that you did not address that was not in the FIREA bill, so I compliment you on the fact is that your strategic plan did include all of those objectives. But the question I have, has Congress really put too much on the platter for you to accomplish in this regard? Are we trying to do too much through the RTC? Are we trying to accomplish too many goals?
Well, I don't think there is any disagreement about what the central purpose of this exercise is.
And what is that? Tell me about that.
And that is to clean up the
savings and loan mess.
The savings and loan mess, and to restore its regulatory integrity and profile for the future.
Is that your main priority?
I think that is what undergirds everything
in
the strategic plan. I think there are other purposes that have been created, the housing.
But you would say that as you enumerate your strategic plan, that the number one priority, though, is to relieve the pressure on our savings and loan industry.
It's to clean up. We wouldn't be here if we didn't have a mess in the savings loan industry, and there wouldn't be a FIREA.
So you do have a priority as far as the strategic goals is concerned?
Yes, sir.
Well, that's encouraging to know. Secondly, Mr. Chairman, as one of the regulators, along with the Comptroller of the Currency and the FDIC and OTS, are we given any consideration as to some changes we need to make in order to encourage a quicker conversion of savings and loans into banks?
Well, I don't think it's our particular function or purpose to either expedite or to slow such conversions. Those are decisions that are being made in the private sector by individuals under statute. And all that we appropriately should be doing is to evaluate whether or not those particular transactions are adequately capitalized and whether they are safe and sound.
Well, see, that's one of the comments we are already getting from the industry and from our constituents, is that the bill that we pass is not permitting, where it is even a desirable, quicker conversions of institutions that would like to get from the savings and loan industry into the banking industry. And it looks like to me that it would be a responsibility of the regulators to study those requests and to advise Congress if we have put into this legislation some more too stringent of steps to make that conversion. Because every savings and loan that we can save is that one that we may not lose.
Well, I should certainly think, Mr. Barnard, that as we gain experience in the carrying out the FIREA, we are going to learn a number of elements about this process which were not available to either the regulators or the Congress or the administration at the time of enactment. I think it's premature at this stage, however, to draw any conclusions because we're still in the early process of implementing this act. But I can assure you that if we perceive significant problems either in this area or in others associated with the act, essentially through inadvertence, I can assure you that we will bring them to this committee.
Mr. Kearney, do you envision a periodic report to Congress which would include the number of savings and loans closed, the number of the dollar of value of assets acquired, the total assets and inventory and so forth, the total disposal and so forth?
Semi-annually, yes.
Semi-annually? You don't think more frequent reports would be in order?
Well, we are...
I was suggesting quarterly, not monthly.
Okay. We could certainly, I suspect that we'll probably have to do that internally so we could provide that to the Congress. We, as a matter of law, have to provide you semi-annual reports.
Thank you very much.
No. Mr. Schumer?
We're going to complete the first...
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, I thank all the witnesses for being here. I know a number of my colleagues have begun their statements by saying that you have a tremendous task ahead of you and wish you well. I only hope that we're not back here 3 years from now still saying you have a tremendous task ahead of you and we wish you well. And that relates to my first comment dealing with just the speed, the pace, which I am concerned about. And I noticed, Mr. Robson, in your testimony, Secretary Robson, you said better not to do it fast if you don't do it well. And of course, everyone agrees with that. But the ultimate question is why. Could you give us a clear reading, which is not in your testimony? You had estimated back in September that you'd be able to approximately spend $20 billion before October. And now we find that we've only been able really to deal with a limited number of small thrifts. Yes, you're publishing a list of another 43, but that means the work has just begun. It's now January. We've only used $8 or $9 billion, really, in closing down the thrifts. What has happened that has made you, what is the problem that has made the pace go more slowly than initially predicted?
I think it's been a combination of starting up two brand new institutions. I think it's been the effect of broadening, as we have done, the bidding process from one that I think started out on a narrower track. And when I say we, it's really the RTC that's
right.
Done this. And I think it's been the probably normal slowness of getting up and running. As I said earlier to the question of one of your colleagues, I wish it had been faster. I think, and Dan Kearney can buttress me on
it's not
that.
A lack of funds, though, is that correct?
Oh, no.
Okay.
No. And what you alluded to earlier of the $20 billion that was estimated to be spent in the fiscal year 89 was really, it shows you, I think, the slipperiness of estimating in this game.
Right.
I think it was Bill Seidman who said he could spend the 20 in fiscal
right.
89 and ended up, for perfectly good reasons, not being able to close the transaction.
Let me ask you another question related to that, and it's related to the financing scheme, which ended up, you know, being what I at least believe is sort of a jerry-built compromise. You put approximately $8 billion to buy down CDs from troubled thrifts was somewhere between $8 and $10 billion, as I recall. That strikes me as not the most efficient use of the scarce and limited dollars you have, because everywhere we go, our constituents are telling us, don't put another nickel in this thing no matter what. And the very least we can do is assure them that the dollars are being spent with lots of bang for the buck.
Well, these
is there any thought at some point in relinquishing those CDs and spending the money for other purposes, such as closing down thrifts and making depositors whole?
Well, I don't think there's any quarrel with the central objective of this thing, which is to resolve thrifts. I don't think we are in any disagreement on that. The money that is spent on the replacement of high-cost funds while these institutions are in conservatorship or receivership is, in fact, a savings of money for your constituents.
I'm just saying you could use the money more, get more out of using the money for other things than buying these high-rate CDs.
Our first objective is to spend money on resolutions filling the hole and...
Would you consider taking that money and using it for another purpose at some point down the road?
Yes, sir.
I'm not sure that I understand the question.
Not renewing the purpose? CDs.
You mean?
In other words, if we had
Chairman Greenspan or... Go ahead.
Yeah, let me respond to it. I think the issue here is a difficult one in the sense that these monies are displacing high-cost deposits, and ultimately the difference between the high interest rate paid and the cost to the government is a net savings in interest.
Agreed.
At some point, these monies will be, as you suggest, moved out of these areas for other uses. These are part of working capital.
I am relieved.
And by definition, working capital comes and goes, but it never loses its value, but it should seek those areas which maximize
right.
the efficiency of the revenue.
Now, I would argue, and you don't have to, and no one has to answer this, that if we didn't have this plan that you had to spend $20 billion by a certain date, that might not have been done to begin with. But be that as it may, second point, it's a final point, and that is to Chairman Greenspan. You had mentioned, I'm sorry I was out there voting, about my complaints about the potential working capital financing plan. And let me say, and then get your comment, I agree with you that actually, if you were looking at it from a strictly budgetary point of view, working capital should be off budget, off Graham Rudman, on both sides of the ledger. What I am troubled about and what was told to me was going to be an initial plan, although I am now told that the president's budget is probably not going to have it, and I would salute and applaud the president for not having it, is that when they borrowed the money from the Federal Financing Bank, that wouldn't be on Graham Rudman, but when the assets were sold, the other side to the same coin, that would be on Graham Rudman, making the defense, making the peace dividend look to Richard Darman like peanuts. It would be a budgeteer's dream to be able to do that. And I just wanted to clarify with the chairman and perhaps the deputy secretary, although I don't want to put him in a box, or the secretary, Secretary Kemp, that would be bad budgeting and would hide the deficit. And one should, as a budget person, oppose it.
It would be bad budgeting.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Chairman. Time of the gentleman has expired. Mr. Paris, I apologize. We were under the impression that when you had used your comment period at the outset that you had actually been on the first round. We apologize, recognize you now.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman. And let me initially apologize to this very distinguished panel for having been required to be absent here in much of this testimony this morning. A very busy day. Have you forgotten, Jack, how much fun it is to come before a congressional committee? So. Let me just very quickly, Mr. Chairman, I appreciate your consideration. I just have several quick questions. To return to the discussion of my friend from New York, Mr. Schumer, of the roughly $20 billion that's been utilized, it's my understanding that about $9 billion has been case resolution Another $9 billion or so has been to replace high interest cost cash funds, and a couple of billion for liquidity needs. Now that adds up, obviously, to $20 billion. My question is, on the legislation, the Treasury, the Secretary of the Treasury can advance or utilize an additional $5 billion a quarter for all of that, and if you just simply extrapolate that over time, and what I'm trying to get to is the pace of this thing and the timing. If you extrapolate that in a straight line, obviously in a year and a half, or roughly that, you're going to have gone through $50 billion.
I would hope so. I think it's going to depend on the pace of resolution, and our goal is to see that it goes forward as fast as it can.
And interest rates?
And a lot of other things. If, as I said, if a lot more institutions get sick,
the value of assets,
it's a harder job.
Yeah, all the rest of it. But is 5 years still reasonable, in your opinion?
I think it's technically seven, but in any event, the it's a big job, and we as Congress fashioned this, they tried to provide a period of time they thought that this job could be done in. It's too early to tell whether that was optimistic or not, but I think that the pieces are there and the structure is there to get it done, and certainly people are putting their shoulder to the wheel to see that it happens.
Well, that's what I'm really trying to get at, Mr. Robson, and I understand the your name is not Gene Dixon, and people who use crystal balls eat a lot of broken glass. But what I'm trying to find out is the 5 years and the $50 billion still, in your general opinion, from what you know now, reasonable in terms of the basis of our decisions on the legislation?
I want to go back to what I said in my testimony, which is I can't tell you with certainty, and I don't believe anyone in this room or any other room can tell you with certainty whether the $50 billion is going to be enough.
I understand.
It depends on a whole bunch of different factors, and if they all come out on the rosy side, this thing will happen beautifully. We're going to keep looking at this thing as it goes along. People are going to get up in front of you and say, gee whiz, I think it's going to cost more than $50 billion to do this job. And our feeling is, when we come to the point where we believe that's the case and we do not have the resources to go forward, you can bet your life we're going to be back here. We aren't there yet.
Well, I was at that point when we adopted the FIREA legislation, Mr. Robson. Just one last quick question. When do you plan to announce a replacement for Danny Wall at the OTS, Mr. Robson? Can you share that with us?
We're working on the recruitment as actively as we can, Mr. Paris, and I wouldn't want to try to speculate on a specific date. It's certainly nothing we're trying to delay.
Well, it's been, what, roughly 6 weeks now since our friend Mr. Wall departed.
In December.
Yeah. I would urge the appropriate authorities to expedite the leadership in that area if they could. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Frank?
I guess to Mr. Kearney, but also to all members of the board. The statute says that the corporation may agree to sell below net realizable market value, both single-family and multifamily, if necessary to accomplish our purposes of low income. To what extent, during this interim plan, do you intend to utilize that authority?
During the interim period, we are going to be testing the statutorily mandated right of first refusal, and we will not be using the provision you referred to.
Well, you say this. I hope you're not suggesting that there's something in the mandate that says you shouldn't do that.
No, I'm not suggesting that.
Well, now you say, let me ask you about secondary exploring opportunities to work with secondary market entities to provide housing for low and moderate income families. What are you doing about that?
That's we have had discussions with both Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, as has Secretary Kemp, and we are proceeding with those discussions. We haven't.
You're only proceeding with discussions. In the interim period, is it what's going to be done about it?
During the 90-day period, there won't be any.
Well, the statute says you shall. No, it does say you shall explore the opportunities.
Right.
So in other words, you explored them, but you couldn't find any.
No, we haven't.
Well, you're going to sell some of this housing without it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And the statute said you shall explore the opportunities. I say that because my colleagues on the other side said, give them discretion, don't be mandatory. And what you're telling us now is you're not going to use the discretion that you were given to sell these below market. You're not going to follow the mandate that you, well, I take it back, you're going to explore the opportunities, but you're going to be very unsuccessful. At the exploration.
I wouldn't want to prejudge the
You've already prejudged it. You've already prejudged that the exploration is going to be unsuccessful. You've been mandated to explore it, and you know that we're not going to succeed, so you can't find it. I'm very distressed. Now, you say you're going to do this without selling below market. It says here that you may sell below market if necessary to accomplish the lower income goals. You believe you're going to accomplish the lower income goals without any discount?
I believe that we're going to find out at the end of our 90-day period what the results have been.
Well, so you're going to have sold some of the, will you have sold some of the eligible property then that won't have met this goal?
Hopefully, we will have sold some of the properties.
And but what happens to that stock of property if you find out that you were wrong or that you do need some discounts? We'll have a diminished stock of property?
We will have whatever units are sold.
How do you define the? How do you understand our goal? It says to necessary to meet the goals in terms of low-income housing. Let me read it to you specifically. To comply with the lower-income occupancy requirements applicable to such property under paragraphs 2 and 3. I wonder if you tell me what your understanding of them is.
I'm not.
Well, let me tell you what my problem
exactly
is.
Sure.
My problem is this. Again, in the spirit of compromise, we said that these could go to people up to 115% of median.
Right.
And my understanding is that what you're going to wind up doing is selling almost all of them to people at 115% of median.
No, I think we'll find out whether we sell them.
Yeah, but you'll have sold them, and you'll have found out that property that could have been sold to low-income people was sold to other people. And the low-income people will then have no property to live in.
If they're however, they'll be sold to people within the statutory.
Yeah, 115%. That's right. You're going to sell them all. Well, am I wrong that you're going to probably sell almost all of them at the high end?
I don't know. I don't know.
Let me ask you if you would be bothered by that result.
I'd
if
be
it turns,
concerned.
Would you consider
that,
it?
I would.
Let me ask you a question. No, I'm sorry. I only have a limited amount of time and less patience. I've got to be honest with you, because I think that the majority of this board is failing to comply with the true spirit of this legislation, and it's going to wind up depriving us of an opportunity to do some low-income housing ownership and some other things. If it turns out that by not finding any secondary market advantages, because you're not going to do those, you say, in this time, and not selling at any discount, you do sell the property, and that overwhelmingly the occupancy in this category is people at 115% of median, which conceitedly the statute allows. Will that satisfy the statute in your judgment? Will you think that was a success?
Well, let me just say this, Mr. Frank. With respect to this pilot program, we're talking about 100 units. We're talking about median incomes in many of this in the areas where these properties are located, ranging from anywhere from the mid-30s to the mid-40s. We're talking about properties that can well be afforded by people with less than the 115% of median. We will know what we know.
Thank you. Now would you answer my question?
90 days period.
If it turns out that almost all, yeah, but you're going to get information and project it forward, and I would like you to answer my question. If it turns out that as a consequence of you not using any secondary market advantages here and not succeeding in your exploration and not giving the discount that the statute says you may give, if it turns out that virtually all the properties sold to meet this are people who are at or very near to the 115% of median, will you consider that a success, and will you consider that those you can project those policies forward?
We will certainly consider that when we review.
Please answer the question. I know you'll consider it. I know today is Tuesday. I'm trying to understand. You're telling us you've got an experiment. I think it's fair for me to ask what the criteria are by which you're going to judge success or not. If it turns out, now the statute allows you, in the most literal sense, so I think you'll wind up with some lawsuits if you do it, to give no discounts as long as you can sell every single unit that's eligible, as we described, to people right at 115%. I'm asking you if you think that would be an appropriate result, or if everybody.
I don't think it's a likely result.
Good. You've answered a whole lot of questions. I don't know who asked them. Now would you answer mine? I don't think it is a tricky question to say to you, on your experiment that you have devised, if it turns out that the sale is mostly to people at about 115% or close to that. Will that be considered, in your judgment, compliance, successful, or not? Now, let me ask the members of the board, since I'm not going to get an answer out of Mr. Kearney. Greenspan, would you consider that the spirit of the statute?
Yeah, in a way, I think you really ought to ask the board members that question, which is a policy issue. And the answer to your question is I think that we understand the spirit of this legislation and will act accordingly. And specifically with respect to your question, if it is legalistic in that sense, I think we would be violating the spirit of this legislation.
Right.
The answer to your question is if it comes out exactly the way you suggest, I think we would be disturbed.
I appreciate it. If it were in the 100 to 115% range. Thank you. Mr. Secretary Kemp?
Well, I appreciated Chairman Greenspan's comments because I agree with him. I believe with the thrust of your question. The measure to me of a successful affordable housing program, Mr. Chairman, is whether it reaches the low and moderate income purchaser. And so I would hope that this program will reach people below that 115% median. And it's no secret that I believe that we discussed this quite candidly, price discounts and subsidies too.
Well, I thank
but
you for that.
The board went ahead on the premise that we were going to monitor those initial sales while we were resolving our working capital needs.
I won't ask you whether you think roll calls ought to be published on the board, Mr. Secretary, but I take it then that I'm being reassured here that the absence of any discounting on the net realizable market value and the failure to really take advantage of secondary market entities to provide housing, that those are unlikely to survive into the permanent plan. At least I hope not. Mr. Robeson?
Let me just, I think there's been a theme which I guess I'd like to confront of the fact that we didn't employ the maximum tools available.
Let me correct that.
As being somehow.
Not that you didn't employ the maximum, it's my theme that you quite consciously and deliberately selected the minimum. I never thought we'd get the maximum. But not that you, I'm not charging you with having failed to do the maximum. I am charging you with quite deliberately having done the minimum.
Well, I suppose it depends on which end of the stick you're looking at. But in any event, I do want to say, and I really, I think I speak on behalf of the board on this, there certainly is no conscious desire to subvert an element of the law that is there. Our approach was one of saying a 90-day right of first refusal was provided. It has an element of subsidy in it. It may...
What's the element of subsidy in it?
You're holding a property off the market for 90 days, and that has a cost attached to it.
But I thought... And you're going to be selling others?
I'm sorry?
You're going to be selling others in those 90 days?
Any time you delay for...
I understand, but do you expect to get a lot of other sales in that 90-day period?
Other than affordable housing?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure there'll be other assets sold in other places. But the point that I'm...
My point simply is that the 90-day clock is starting to run, and I think what we're going to find out is that the actual amount of delay involved in that won't be very much. So the element of subsidy for holding it off the market will be minuscule.
But I think the real point is that... if we find that the objectives are not being accomplished, I don't think anyone on this board is going to say,
right, but
so what?
But Mr. Robeson, that's my problem. That's what I tried to get from Mr. Kinney, and I was nervous that he didn't feel confident to answer my question, because you could be within compliance if you went to 115, and I need reassurance that, and I'm glad to hear from Secretary Kemp, we hope that some people at 50% and below will get some of this, that it is possible to get technical compliance. And the point is this. Legislating, as you all know, is compromise. Now, I didn't get everything I wanted here. My colleagues on the other side particularly said, give them some discretion. So there's some may's in here. But if may becomes fat chance, then some of us have to come back and say, hey, no more discretion. Then they got to get mandated. And I will also tell you that the impression has been given to many of those most interested in taking advantage of this that they're going to get a hard time. Now, you told me that that's an incorrect impression. I am delighted to hear that. They're here, and I hope they'll hear it, and we'll explore this Thursday. But with regard to clearing houses, with regard to secondary market, with regard to a whole bunch of other things, I'm told that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac do not feel that full advantage has been taken of their services. I want you to prove me wrong, but I got to tell you, at this point, the impression that has been conveyed to the people most interested in carrying this out is that, understandably, the RTC's goal is to get as much money as possible, as quickly as possible. That's a valid consideration, but at the expense of living up to the spirit of these things. And I look forward to being proved wrong in this instance, not often.
time of the gentleman has expired for some time. I wanted to say in furtherance here one note so that this 90-day period, I noticed the Deputy Secretary referred to it as a concessionary or a subsidy period. HUD reports to us that the average time nationally in at the time they acquire or possess property and its disposition is 7.5 months. In my city of San Antonio, the average is 8 months. So I think, Mr. Frank, that you keep that in mind, because I recall when you offered the amendment and had the 90-day preferential period. Anyway, I thought I would.
Mr. Chairman, if you'll yield to me 1 second, I think if we had told them they had to sell it in 90 days, they would have told us that was an impossible task. So holding it off the market for 90 days hardly seems to me to be an enormous amount of subsidy.
Ah, Mr. Frank, I'm afraid that you have prejudiced your mind. Mr. Carper.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And gentlemen, welcome, and thank you for your patience here today. Let me ask a question, if I can, of Deputy Secretary Robson. How long have you been in your position, sir?
Here at the Treasury Department?
Yes, sir.
Since sworn in May of 1989.
All right. I'm going to ask you to just go back about a year with us and revisit some assumptions that we made when the Congress passed a $50 billion plan. And among those assumptions, we made certain assumptions, I think, encouraged by the administration for interest rates. We made certain assumptions about the inflow of deposits. We made certain assumptions on how much money we'd be able to recapture in selling assets from the failed thrifts. We made some, perhaps some assumptions about land values. Do you recall any of those assumptions?
I was not here at the time the bill was introduced, and I don't know what they are specifically, no.
Do any of our panel members recall any of those assumptions?
Is that what he's talking about?
Yes.
Well, I'm reminded of one assumption that was made with respect to growth rates of thrifts, which were the source of premiums for the safe insurance fund, which I recall was set originally at 7%.
So we assume that new deposits within thrifts will grow annually at about 7%? Feel free, if you want to consult someone behind you, feel free to.
No, I believe that's correct.
All right. What's happening?
They haven't grown at that rate, and the effect of that, of course, will be ultimately to reduce the inflow from deposits that are into the safe fund. However, it won't change the ultimate commitment that Congress has made to the SNL cleanup. It doesn't affect that. It affects the source of the funds. That commitment, I believe, is already in the FERIA bill.
All right, let me just back up. We assume that the net inflows to SNLs would grow annually by 7%.
Right.
And our experience has been that they are growing by less than that. They are not growing at all, or they're shrinking.
That is correct.
Which one? That was a multiple choice.
They are not growing at that rate.
Well, I think that clarify the issue. In the current budget that is being submitted, the estimate now is for zero growth in thrift deposits.
All right.
Down from 7.2%.
What is actually happening in terms of deposit growth within SNLs?
The actual growth has been negative.
It's negative?
Right.
And by roughly how much?
Well, a fairly significant amount, as a number of these institutions are being
resolved.
All right. When we're trying to think of how much working capital we might need, we've already guessed wrong once. We guessed that deposits would flow back into SNLs at a hefty rate. They have not. We're now about to figure out how much working capital we may need. And I guess my question is, are we going to assume 0% and find that we're going to be disappointed again?
Yeah, well, no, I think the more crucial issue to the problem you are appropriately raising, Mr. Carper, is not the overall estimate of what the growth is in the savings and loan industry. But the degree and the rapidity of the resolution of those thrifts which are in conservatorship or those which will be in conservatorship. And it really gets to a question of, I think, an issue which Mr. Bento raised earlier with respect to the difference between whether or not you're replacing deposits or whether you're replacing assets. It's to the extent that in the resolution that assets are accumulated in receiverships which must be funded pending their sale. It's that assumption which is crucial to how much working capital must be built up. And I doubt very much if the particular assumption which is being made with respect to the growth in the thrifts overall, the total industry, really impacts that crucially on the working capital question.
Sometimes I like to say that the first person any president appoints to his cabinet is a gal named Rosie Scenario. I think that when we passed our legislation last year, Rosie Scenario was at work on interest rate assumptions, on deposit inflows, on land values, and on our assumptions and the administration's assumptions and just how much money we'd be able to recapture on the sale of those assets. I would just caution us as we move forward in trying to figure out how much working capital we do need, that we play with real numbers, that we set Rosie aside, and we use realistic expectations.
I believe time of the gentleman has expired.
I believe my time has expired, sir. Thank you.
Did the gentleman have a sentence he wishes to complete?
I had a few more questions, Mr. Chairman, but I know there are others on the committee who do as well. Thank you.
We must march on then. Mr. Dreyer, did you have any questions? I noticed you've come aboard.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's nice to be here, nice to see you, and Happy New Year to you and to my colleagues. I, too, would like to thank the panel and shift issues, if I could, briefly. I just got back from six countries in Eastern Europe, and one of the issues that was discussed there is, of course, something that we're going to be facing. And we have a task force which has just been set up under Chairman LaFalce dealing with international competitiveness. And one of the things I'd like to ask this expert panel is what recommendations, as we look towards EC 92, would you all have as it relates to restructuring the U.S. financial system, which is a challenge which I hope very much we will take on this year. And we've dealt with this issue for a decade. We've seen some problems come from actions of this committee and the Congress. But we're going to be looking now at this EC challenge, which may expand into those countries, which I've just come from. So I'd like to ask you, Chairman Greenspan, Secretary Kemp, and any of the other panelists who'd like to comment on where we should head as far as dealing with the challenge of EC 92 as it relates to U.S. financial institutions.
Well, Prior, I think you're raising a rather fundamental question which relates to the financial structure of our system through the 1990s and beyond. I doubt very much if we could respond appropriately to that very broad question in the time frame that we have. But I do think...
I won't ask any more questions, Mr. Chairman. You can spend my whole 5 minutes responding to it.
I don't think I could answer the question appropriately in five minutes. Nor, I do think, however, that we have to be aware of the increasing internationalization of the world's financial system. We are finding that globally, the flows of funds are becoming so large that they invariably impact all of our financial institutions in this country, whether they be depository or whether they be non-depository institutions. And clearly, since many of our institutions will be competing in the rest of the world, and their viability will depend on their structure. If we want to maintain our leadership in world finance, then it is very apparent that we have to make certain that our structure addresses that. And I do believe that in many hearings, which will, many of the witnesses that come before this committee in the months ahead will be directly or indirectly addressing this issue of necessity, since it is crucial to our domestic welfare, our domestic standard of living, and the future of the country.
Well, if there were one or two particular items that you would put right at the top as far as immediate changes that we ought to launch into to deal with EC-92, what would they be?
Probably force me to start repeating testimony which our chairman has heard me utter more often than I suspect he would like with respect to Glass-Steagall Act and a number of the structural problems which in last session I commented on in considerable detail. And just for the record, I would just say that I know of nothing that has occurred which would alter the view that the Federal Reserve Board brought to this committee just about a year ago, Mr. Chairman.
That's right.
So you have no great changes in the hiatus since we've been out of session over what we've heard in the past?
I would think not at this point.
Will the gentleman yield to me?
Oh, I'm happy to yield to you, Mr. Chairman.
I think the chairman has answered quite to the point. I think the question or the issue, subject matter that you're broaching is extraneous to the purposes of this hearing, but they will be the subject matter of hearings either on the subcommittee level by Mr. Fauntroy's subcommittee on international institutions or the full committee, as the chairman reminded us we started out a year ago almost, about 11 months ago.
I just brought it up, Mr. Chairman, from having just returned from that part of the world and working.
Sure, you're still
meeting in an hour with Mr. LaFalce on our task force on competitiveness, and that's what led me to bring it up.
I saw you walk in late, so I figure that you're still suffering from jet lag. But,
Well, Mr. Chairman, as you know, I go weekly to California, so maybe I'm always in that state.
Oh, yeah, but you get accustomed to that. Your body clock adjusts automatically.
Thank you very much, Mr.
Chairman.
But you
came from Eastern Europe, you said, and that's a few hours more, and no telling where in Eastern Europe you wandered around, but...
Well, I'm not going to give you a full report. I have no plans to give you a full report now.
If the gentleman will please, we'll continue with recognizing some of the members that haven't had a chance on the first round yet.
Thank you, Mr.
McMillan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would, first of all, like to add my support to words that Mr. Shumway and Mr. Hubbard and Mr. Kemp spoke about the need for possible transition rules and the one borrower regulations, and I hope that the appropriate regulators will take a look at this. With regard to the strategic plan, as I mentioned earlier in my opening comments, RTC is supposed to come up with a budget specifying the utilization of the private sector, and that'll be 60 days after the issuance of the strategic plan. I understand on January 12th, there was a board meeting, there was some discussion of the first quarter's budget for the RTC, and at that meeting there was a discussion of an 80% performance target of the private sector as a utilization rate. Is that correct, Mr. Robeson?
Excuse me, Mr. McMillan. I believe that's
Mr.
the RTC board that had that discussion.
I should refer to that. Yeah, I apologize. Is that correct?
I believe that is correct, but you'll have to ask them tomorrow. But I believe that they did discuss that.
That is your understanding and is congruent with your strategic plan. Do you have any idea of the, I mean, you've obviously seen some preliminary budget figures for the RTC. What type of staffing level are they looking at for the first quarter?
I believe that they are projecting 1,900 full-time personnel.
But with an 80% utilization of the private sector.
Yes.
That's good. Well, I just want to again say that that is certainly in congruence with the FIREA statute, and I'm personally very pleased with that. With regards to FATO, I would like to ask a question. A number of us worked on that issue. That their liquidation is now being handled by the FDIC's liquidation office. Is it true or your understanding that the rules and the procedures for dealing with FATA are going to be the same as with the RTC, in other words, the utilization of the private sector and all the other aspects. Will the strategic plan apply to the liquidation of FATA as well?
Yeah, the FATA has been assumed by the RTC, no. So I guess it would. It would.
It is, even though it's being handled by the liquidation division of the FDIC.
I believe that is.
Okay. But so it is your understanding that the same procedures will apply?
I think so, but I'd have.
So that would mean an 80% utilization of the private sector and likewise?
That if they did apply, that's correct.
Okay. I will again ask these questions tomorrow.
Right.
Let me just follow up on Mr. Carper's comment. You know, a lot of us in Congress, I think what you hear across the room here is a concern that there's an obfuscation on the part of the administration with regards to the real extent of this S&L problem, that we came in here with very rosy and optimistic assumptions, 7% deposit growth, long-term interest rates at 4%, no recession, no inflation, and about a 20% recovery rate on assets, which is far below even what FDIC is recovering right now. Clearly there was a certain degree of optimism. And I think the concern here is whether the working capital issue is being used to try and cover up, if you will, the extent of this problem. When will we receive from Treasury a new estimation of the cost of this bailout?
Well, as I said,
based on new assumptions, if you
will. Yeah, and I guess I'd like to go back to the, a little back to the beginning on this. The goal here is to meet the responsibilities that the United States has to the depositors in these institutions. We put forward a plan to do that. The Bush administration did. The Congress, I think, is arm in arm with us on accomplishing that goal. We came in with figures which were based on, at that time, the best estimates from FDIC, from a bunch of, from the Fed, from a variety of places. We said at that time, I said in my testimony today, we said last October, things can change. And the assumptions that you made 9, 10 months ago may alter. As they do, we think it's our job to keep our eye on them, to keep you apprised of when we have changes that materially affect the implementation of this program, and that if we come to a point where we do not have the resources to go forward, to come up and tell you so and ask you for funds. Well, now, we aren't there yet.
Well, that sounds very nice, but all those assumptions are dead wrong. I mean, they're absolutely dead wrong. I mean, none of them are even close. I mean, we have an inflationary economy. Our economy's in a, you know, not long-term rates are not going down to 4%. At some point in time, I think it's incumbent upon the administration to say, look, here's a new set of assumptions, and the cost of this resolution is going to be this. And what my question is, because my time has run out, when will that happen? At what point in time will the snapshot come where the administration will say, we have reevaluated the assumptions, and as a result of that, there's a different figure beside $50 billion out there? When will that happen?
I don't think there's a fixed date for that to happen, Mr. McMillan. It's a continuing process of examining what the facts are. If all of a sudden 1,000 thrifts that everyone thought were perfectly healthy fell into the clutches of RTC, you'd say, my God, this thing's going to cost us a lot more. We don't have that circumstance. We're looking at the same numbers that that everyone is, and is. And as you say, the this is going to change. We're going to see new figures from the Office of Thrift Supervision, which looks at this industry on a continuing basis, and there'll probably be more thrifts that they're going to put on their watch list, as I said in my testimony, and that says to you, maybe this thing's going to cost more. How much? You can't tell. When will the costs accrue? You can't tell.
I appreciate it. My time has expired. Let me just say issues are very much interwoven. And obviously, when we resolve the working capital issue, it will be very important that we have a good snapshot at what assumptions the administration is using.
Could I just add one more thing and then ask Chairman Greenspan, and that is, I think it's terribly important to come back to the point that we've tried to make all along, and that is, we have today ample resources to move forward on this problem as aggressively as we possibly can. I can't think of anything different that we do today. If I were able to come to you with a set of assumptions that said, Mr. McMillan, I think this is now going to be a $56.5 billion problem or a $68.5 billion problem, than we are doing today.
Can I just add a point here? First, I think, Mr. McMillan, one statistic that we look at, which I suggest would be useful in this respect, are the actual booked losses. In other words, up to date, the losses are $6.4 billion against the 50. If you begin to see those cumulative losses begin to go beyond, or look as though it's going beyond our estimates for the particular institutions involved, that's a signal that our assumptions are going off. Secondly, I don't think the actual estimating procedure with respect to the amounts of money involved depend on those types of rosy scenarios. There is a realistic set of numbers and estimates which are applied based on actual resolutions and projections, which, in my judgment, are as realistic as you can get. Having said that, let me just reinforce what the Deputy Secretary says, that you still have got some very wide ranges of possibilities which we cannot legitimately narrow without doing violence to what our knowledge is. But I do think that it's crucially important that we try to keep as close as we can to what the realities of the resolutions are, what the marketplaces are doing, and what specifically is happening in the areas of the thrift industry which are not now under conservatorship or contemplated as conservatorship. Because I think, as the Deputy Secretary points out, it's there where differences can occur, and we really have no great insight, nor does anybody, on exactly how profitable or unprofitable a vast chunk of those institutions now not in our purview are going to be.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Mr. Kennedy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Robson, you indicated that on page 10 of your testimony, there are several paragraphs that indicate the reasons why you would like to have the $50 billion worth of working capital. At best, they are difficult to fully understand. And yet, $50 billion sounds like real money to me. I wonder whether or not, in just looking at the whole circumstance that we're dealing with here, that the same kinds of, and you've also indicated that if the $50 billion worth of bailout funds isn't enough, that you're going to be coming right back up here and asking for more. And yet, the one portion of this bill that dealt with the needs of many of the working people and poor people of our country that are ending up paying for this bailout, the benefit that they were going to receive was the eligible housing program, which seems to be largely forgotten. Secondly, as I know Secretary Kemp is aware, there is an affordable housing program, which was also part of this legislation. And Mr. Greenspan, I think that with the difficulties that so many of our nation's banks are facing with regard to meeting their CRA and HMDA responsibilities, that there might be an opportunity here to try to advance the affordable housing program into an area that the banks themselves that are under difficulties with regard to CRA and HMDA might be able to participate in. And it just seems to me to be sitting on the back burner largely because of positions that aren't filled or some such excuse, Jack, which I'm sure you recognize is just that, as an excuse, that we ought to be able to move forward. I know that we talked earlier, late last year, about the fact that we'd have temporary regs in place by January 1st of this year. It's just that that money, those Federal Home Loan Bank profits are just sitting there. And it just, you know, the committee has spoken out, said that they want 5% of those funds used for the purposes of affordable housing. We're ignoring the needs of the poor on one hand in this whole equation, as I'm sure you'd acknowledge, Mr. Robson. Then it seems to me that we ought to be able to move forward and get this program up and running to some degree. Secretary Kemp?
Well, I want to assure you, as I have earlier today, that there is no one that I know of who is going to ignore, nor would I, as a member of the Oversight Board and as the chairman of the Federal Housing Finance Board, there's no way we would ignore that very key responsibility. And I suggested earlier, although I don't know if you were here at that moment, but I said that we are within days of issuing and promulgating those regulations, which I believe will unlock the use of that 5%, or what we calculate to be $78 million, that could be leveraged up to $1 billion in the private sector for the very worthwhile and noble goals to which you and I both subscribe. So I just want to assure you face to face that there is not going to be anyone that ignores it. And I am a housing secretary who believes in the purposes of the legislation. And as chairman of the Federal Housing Finance Board, we're going to make sure that it goes forward.
Mr. Greenspan, thank you, Mr. Kemp. Mr. Greenspan, I wonder if you might be willing to comment on the difficulty that so many of our banks that are losing money today, particularly in my region of the country, and their dilemma with regard to adhering to the CRA and HMDA regulations that they now, in some cases, feel should not be imposed on them because of the other financial difficulties that they may have gotten themselves into.
As you are aware, Congressman, the application of CRA and HMDA do require that it be done in a safe and sound manner so that we do not undercut the viability of the depository institution, because if that institution is to serve its community, obviously, first and above all, it must be safe and sound.
Mr. Chairman, are you suggesting that the safety and soundness would be undercut by CRA and HMDA, or is it other
financial considerations that cause that? I'm saying that if an institute, if there is a choice in the regulator's evaluation or their application of their legislative requirements, first has to be safety and soundness, because if that is not accomplished, then the institution will not exist. But having said that, we are still obligated to make certain that CRA, in the context that that institution is viewed as having an obligation to adhere to move as expeditiously as we can. And I think there is a renewed awareness amongst my fellow governors of the need to make certain that CRA is appropriately adhered to. And I merely only say it in the context of when we are dealing with an institution which is in basic difficulty, we have to remember that if an institution is to serve its community, it first has to be a sound institution. And that's the nature, I think, the necessary priority that we see.
That's fine, Mr. Chairman, but I'm glad to hear you say that the governors have a renewed awakening with regard to the CRA and HMDA issues, because I think they are critically important to the poor people and the working people in this country.
In all candor, Congressman, I think that the Congress's views on this issue, and specifically this committee, has been an issue which we have responded to and are aware of.
Well, we've talked about it a number of times.
Yes, and I think
it wasn't responded to so directly.
Well, no, but I think of what I'm saying is that those conversations were not without value.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One last question. I understood, Mr. Robson, that you have some difficulties in dealing with the valuations of the properties that you're trying to sell. Is the 95% rule getting in your way of actually making some of these distributions or not?
I'll let me refer that to Dan Carney.
No, not at this time, Congressman Kennedy.
That's not been a problem.
No.
Fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Hoagland.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for recognizing me. Chairman Greenspan, my first question is to you, and it has to do with what I think more and more people are perceiving now is the overexposure of the American taxpayer through the deposit funds to really limitless liabilities as we go into the next century. When you combine the $100,000 insurance limit, which is subject to proliferation, of course, with the too big to fail policy, it seems to me that the U.S. government really is on the line for about any losses in a deposit institution in the country. And I wonder if you agree with that, if you think that we here in Congress should be looking for ways to pull back government's exposure through the insurance guarantee.
Yeah. Mr. Tobel, this is the central issue of deposit insurance that confronts all the regulators. I myself am very uncomfortable with the too big to fail notion. I think that it is inappropriate in a free market financial system, and it potentially imposes inordinate burdens on the American taxpayer. In fact, the overall issue of guarantees that the federal government has, of which deposit insurance is a very big part, is something which I think will become increasingly before this committee in the years ahead, because it's beyond the issue of on budget or off budget. It is contingent liabilities, and those numbers are very large. How we ultimately resolve this question is not yet clear. There is, as a result of FIREA, a requirement on the part of the Treasury to engage in a study on a number of these issues, and I would presume that in testimony before this committee on deposit insurance and other issues, I hope we will flesh out some of the nature of the difficulties, but more importantly, I hope we can find a realistic solution to this problem, which has really bedeviled regulators now for a number of years. We're caught between the necessity to make certain that our financial system overall is sound and not be in a position where it's the federal government which essentially guarantees the liabilities of the system, because it is not costless. I don't mean in terms of taxpayer funds. I mean to the extent that the federal government guarantees the liabilities of financial institutions, real interest rates are higher than they would otherwise be. In other words, it's not a free lunch. To the extent that we implicitly or explicitly guarantee those liabilities, we are confronting the economy and the average householder with higher interest rates than should be the case.
Well, I appreciate those observations, Mr. Chairman, and I'm hopeful that the committee will be able to come up with some sort of a system which injects more market discipline into the current system. I think we have no market discipline right now when we insure virtually all funds, and we need to work that into the equation somehow. Secretary Robson, on a much less glamorous subject, and maybe this is more appropriate for Mr. Carney, I'm getting reports back in my district that that the current policy of not having available funds for open thrift assistance is at least in some cases mistaken, because there are some institutions where with a little bit of open thrift assistance early on, we could save much larger losses later on. I wonder what your thoughts are about the advisability of making open thrift assistance available, at least in those situations where it's clear that the losses would be less to the taxpayer.
Well, as you're probably aware, Mr. Hoagland, in the strategic plan, we took a fairly reserved position on the question of
of open thrift assistance, primarily because we are concerned that the judgment as to what will ultimately help the taxpayer gets to be very clouded by being too close to the situation, and that the criteria for making these kinds of gestures of assistance are very difficult to administer. We have always said at the same time, and the RTC, I believe, has asked us to take a look at that question again, that we would look at it, and if we come to the conclusion that there are some ways in which we could appropriately authorize open thrift assistance, I think we should consider it if it'll end up saving the taxpayer. But I'll say that against the backdrop of, I think, a great caution among the members of the board and Mr. Carney that that is a very slippery piece of ground.
I think one, if I may add one thing, one of the key elements that the board wanted to look at is the experience of the FDIC in open bank assistance transactions, and we've asked for that analysis from the FDIC, and we're getting it soon.
So it sounds like it's not a closed issue by any means, and it may very well be available in the future in an appropriate situation.
It is possible.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm with the gentleman who's expired. Mr. Mpumi.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I have a question for Mr. Kearney related to something that was raised earlier. I'd like to know if you could explain to the committee how the RTC intends to meet the provisions of, as they relate to concerning lower income housing, who will be the clearinghouses, and whether or not there will be any special financing through RTC. And if I could also ask Secretary Kemp whether or not HUD has taken the program into consideration as part of its overall housing mission, and whether or not HUD is coordinating with RTC on financing aspects. And to both of you, whether or not the Congress should be looking at modifying any current formulas as it relates to subsidy distribution.
With respect to the clearinghouses, the statute mandates that the Federal Housing Finance Board, Mr. Kemp's agency, and the state housing finance agencies be clearinghouses, and we have designated those particular entities as clearinghouses without precluding participation by nonprofit or other interested groups as clearinghouses. With respect to the Housing Finance Board, Secretary Kemp did describe that program, and I think I'll let him know.
Well, the answer is there is coordination between HUD, FHA, of course, the Federal Housing Finance Board, and the RTC. I said I talked earlier, Quasi, about the imminent promulgation of those regs that would allow the Federal Housing Finance Board through the home loan bank system to utilize up to the 5% in the law of funds that would, I think, be $78 million. We're about ready to go with those regs. Mm-hmm. There is coordination, and there is no secret that I had thought previously in my testimony before this committee that some type of a subsidy for affordable housing would be required. We've talked about that a little bit here and today, but I am convinced that as we move forward and carefully and closely monitor the sales and the disposition of these assets, that we'll have a better understanding of the responsibilities that were given to us through the Act of FIREA with regard to low and moderate income people getting access to the type of affordable housing that you're talking about.
Let me ask you, are you prepared to make any suggestions on what sort of modifications ought to occur in those formulas for subsidies? Do you think it's too early, or do you think that... things that we should be looking at here...
Seller financing or price discounts, below market rate financing, discounted price. I assured the chairman earlier that I would, along with my colleagues on the board, and I know that Dan feels the same way, we're going to very closely and carefully monitor so that we're not only fulfilling the objective or the strict interpretation of the law, but what some have called the spirit of the law,
because we share that goal in this administration to make sure that affordable housing is front and center in this nation's housing policy.
Mr. Robson, let me go back to this issue of contracting for just a moment. In other contracting programs where Hispanic Americans, African Americans, Asian Americans, other minority groups have essentially been lumped together in one group, and then that group lumped in with a group that, for lack of a better term, are women contractors, studies have shown across the nation over and over again that disproportionately, as it relates to minorities, the benefits of those programs seem to flow in an unequal kind of fashion. I'd like to know whether or not you have given any idea to the exploration of setting separate goals for contracting with both minorities and with women contractors.
Dan, could you answer that?
Yeah, we've had discussions with the RTC about set-asides in general. The program that they are to come up with is due up to us at the end of this month, and we will be evaluating that program at that time. I think the question is fairly put to them tomorrow. I don't believe they contemplate making a delineation between women and minorities at this
time. You see, the reason I ask that is that we tend to dilute the effort that we are claiming that we're making, and it's not just this program, it's contracting programs all over, and so both groups end up fighting for the same slice of pie. And the level of frustration, I think, is increased as opposed to being decreased. I'd like to know your thoughts as we move through this process. I hope that we're proactive, we meaning the RTC, and that you're sort of looking down the road at how we can get around some of the things that have been traditional barriers and have posed traditional problems. And I don't think there's any easy answer to that one, but it's something that I continue to raise because I hear, quite honestly, from people, both women and minorities who are looking to contract with this government in various aspects, who find themselves fighting, unfortunately, against one another.
I see. That's a good point. We'll
Mr. Chairman, I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Impumi. Gentlemen, of course, you have been more than patient. You have gone way beyond the ordinary call of duty, and we appreciate it. However, I must sum up because I think that the as we conceive the amendments requiring the 180-day appearance, not just merely reports, as almost all prior legislation had contained, we wanted more than just a formalistic, routine kind of thing. We knew that we were going to have very special need of accountability. Now, the way I've summed that up here this morning's hearing and afternoon, you have stated that you will possibly need $40 to $100 billion in working capital, but you can't tell us when or why, and why. Since you still have access to substantial amounts from REFCOR, and I estimate that to be about $30 billion, how can you expect us to believe that you need working capital now? We need to know how much cash you need, when and how you expect to spend it. Without this information, it is impossible for us to take this question of the alleged cash flow problem very seriously. So succinctly, I would say, how much cash does RTC have now, and that includes this January issue, and what are you doing with that cash?
Well, at the moment, my memory is correct. RTC has about $2.5 billion in cash, to which the January offering of REFCorp will add another $4 to $5 billion,
right.
Mr. Chairman.
Another $5 billion, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, sir. Now, you see, when I've listened to the explanations, and I'll, you know, maybe I'm just not as quick on the draw as perhaps some people give me credit for being. but to me, to say that you have this working capital, and then you have the
deep hole capital. To me, you know, this money is money. You don't have a green color for one or a red color for the other. And I'm confused here as to just how the operating practices are. I'm further troubled by something that was brought out here on the question of the SNLs that have been taken over. These are dead, but they're still being breastfed. So we still have the same thing we had before we had Furia. I mean, what's the difference? We have a drain. I mean, I thought the idea was we were going to have this money, we use that, we do that, which the insurance fund should have been doing since day one, and that is closing down, paying out, and avoiding the taxpayers' liability. So I would submit in writing, because I think it'd be an imposition, and I ask unanimous consent that I be permitted to follow through. There's another basic question that I think we need to have answered today. You described the three options that we had commented on for raising funds for working capital, and that maybe some or all of these options would be used. The question is, am I correct in my assumption that any obligation or guarantee or letter of credit or other liability issued or incurred by the RTC, including those incurred in connection with raising working capital, would be an outstanding obligation for purposes of the maximum amount limitation on the note cap? This is my $64 question. And
yes.
Yes.
It is. The answer is yes. Okay, sir. So my assumption was correct. One final thing, and it has to do with the ethics that's bothersome. One of the tests to determine whether a contractor should be disqualified in the proposed ethics regulation is whether any damage is awarded, and I quote the language, in the past against the contractor for fraud exceeded the lesser of 50% of the net worth of the contractor or its related entities are 10% of the annual gross revenues of the contractor or its related entities. And that's the end of the quote of the language. Now, under this test, as I interpret it, the bigger the contractor, the greater the amount of fraud that the contractor can have committed in the past and still work for RTC. Can you explain why you believe that large contractors should be protected because of their size and be permitted to contract with the RTC even if they have been responsible for millions of dollars of losses to insured institutions?
Mr. Chairman, I'm advised by my staff that I believe a question that's to be included in the questionnaire that the contractor provides to the RTC. I must tell you I'm not familiar with the language you quoted, and I'd like to provide an answer for the record.
Well, may I suggest, why not have a fixed reasonable amount of, say, $50,000 instead of this?
Well, that is the test with respect to loss.
It seems to me to be a real...
Yeah.
I don't know where or who wrote the suggested, but I'd like to know. I'll bet you'll be interesting to find out where it was written.
I will absolutely look at it.
But I think it is, and it should be a source of concern to us. So, and with that, I will defer further questions in writing in sufficient time by the time you receive the transcript of the proceeding. And Mr. Wiley, we'll go round robin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a couple questions which you may want to respond to in writing, and I hesitate to get into this, and I thought it might come out during the course of the questions today, but I was trying to get some figures for a talk recently, and I was told that there are about 333 SNLs that are under RTC control, and that based on the experience or what it can be anticipated from those 333, and I didn't get it from your shop, we might be able to handle another 100, which would take us up to around 430 or 40. Then OTS has indicated that there are about 295 thrifts that are likely failure candidates and another 325 that are distressed, which would be well up in 600. Now, I'd like to think the $50 billion is enough to solve the problem, but if just half of those that are anticipated by OTS is either be likely failure or distressed, that would add to the cost considerably over $50 billion. Do you care to comment on that, Mr. Robson?
Surely. As I said in my testimony and in answers to some of the questions, we expect that OTS, in its newest preliminary look, is going to have a longer watch list than it had the last time it looked at it. And if you make gloomy assumptions on that, you would say to yourself, gee whiz, that's going to inevitably drive the price over $50 billion. And that may be right. On the other hand, you really don't know, and you can't tell today, even if it is correct that it's going to be above $50 billion, how much, when in time those losses may hit. And so it's a perfectly good exercise for someone to go through. It doesn't change what I think we ought to be doing today, which is getting on with the problem with the substantial resources that have already been presented to us. And you are going to get, I am confident, in the course of this exercise, Mr. Wiley, a lot of people saying to you, I think the thing's going to cost X, or I think the thing's going to cost Y. And we're going to try to keep you and your colleagues apprised of the facts as we know them from time to time. Right now, we are perfectly willing to concede, as I did, that it could be above $50 billion. But right now, we don't have a problem with the resources that we have before us, except for working capital. And we don't see that problem cropping up for a while, and we think it's still too darn early to start making guesses about how much it's going to be.
None of us are anxious to get back into firea, especially not in this year. Do you anticipate any changes in firea will be needed to help us make your job easier?
The administration coming forward with the legislative suggestions, I do not sense a high appetite for that in the administration. At least I've not seen one.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I'd ask unanimous consent to submit questions for the record. And Mr. Chairman, just getting into the precedent, of course, Mr. Robson has been set for substituting working capital and the actual bailout dollars in some of the actions that you've taken already. Where did this bonding schedule come from? It didn't come from heaven, obviously. Where did this schedule come from for raising the money? I mean, it is true that you could raise this money much quicker, in my judgment. And I'll get back to that because I have some information on that. But where did this schedule come from?
Well, the basic schedule, and I'll let Mr. Kearney embellish what I say, is on the cash flow projections that RTC does based on how many thrifts it thinks it's...
Well, you didn't include it in your strategic plan, but where did it come from? Didn't it come from the Office of Management and Budget, the REFCO schedule?
No, it did not. Actually, the amount of REFCORP bonds outstanding are a function of how much resources we could tap into from the Federal Home Loan Bank system in order to borrow to buy the treasuries to defease the principal. And $5 billion, and how much we can access in the market, and a $5 billion.
Well, what is your limitation in the market? You have no limitations. You could put these out all in April if you saw it, couldn't you?
Well, you... subject to the constraint that the Chairman Greenspan talked about earlier, which is that the market, the amount of borrowings in any sector of the market is constrained.
Well,
by
I know,
many...
but I mean, you could put them out, though. I mean, I assume that a bond like this with the type of backing isn't going to be substantially different. You'd have to obviously schedule it. No one's saying just go out and sell
bonds. No, I think that $5 billion is still a lot of money to be auctioned off.
Well, of course, and part of this gets back, of course, to Mr. Chairman, to the old on-off budget. And because we have these special bonds, now we're saying we have to have more working capital. And this gets back to the on-off budget argument about the nature of of the bonds rather than doing direct Treasury borrowing. So, I mean, you're kind of worked yourself into one of their own problems here, Mr. Chairman. I think it just keeps getting to be more of a difficulty. But my understanding is that the type of income coming in from the Federal Home Loan Bank boards and the contribution from the in amounts remaining from undivided profits and as well as the safe insurance premiums are about $825, not even counting the FSLIC resolution fund, would be more than enough to put out 6.5 in 40-year bonds or $8.25 billion in 30-year bonds. So it is true that there's enough dollars there that you're opting for this working capital solution. But, you know, the reason we're getting nervous about it is clearly because of the precedent of substituting these dollars back and forth that you established early on in the process. Plus, I think if you check with some of your colleagues in RTC, you're going to find that they look at the money you've put in terms of buying those high-yield certificates as a down payment on resolution, so that it isn't working capital money in that particular sense. Mr. Chairman, just one other point. I noted in reply to Mr. Mfumi's question that you suggested that the minority contracting and other recommendations had not come from the RTC. Is that correct, Mr. Carney?
They are doing, I believe, at the end of this month.
I mean, I know that they're not been published. They've not been approved by the Oversight Board, but has the RTC made the recommendations?
They have draft, but I don't believe they've approved by their board or ours.
Well, they are before you, though.
I'm sorry?
They are before you.
We have had draft regulations.
Okay. The other point is that in terms of the housing provisions are also before you, are they not?
Yes.
My concern here is the length of time. Obviously, if we're talking about the viability of the Oversight Board, the question is the length of time that it takes. Could you provide the full committee and the task force, I would ask, Mr. Chairman, with a log of the number of policy questions that you've dealt with and the length of time, not getting into detail, but just identifying them. Could you do that, Mr. Carney?
Sure. We did receive the affirmative housing regulations Friday.
Did you, have you, I appreciate that. In some cases, is initiated and said this is a policy issue, we're pulling it up from the RTC and not let their board approve it? I know they bounce things up to you regularly, but have you, in fact, asserted an extra beyond this particular point?
The very first policies we put out, Mr. Bento, were ours, and we've put out others since then that were initiated at the Oversight Board.
I know, but did you pull issues back from the RTC at your behest where you said this is a policy issue and not something that can only be done by the board? In other words, I'm talking about friction between the two, where they have started to go forth with a rule or something, and you pulled it back and saying it's a policy.
I can't think of an instance where that's happened, but Dan, you may be able to. We've had differences of views over policies that we were shaping, and we try to do them in consultation with the RTC,
right.
But I can't recall a case where we've yanked one back.
Mr. Chairman, just one other question. In responding to Mr. Frank's questions dealing with the low-income housing, doesn't the strategic plan, in fact, say that you will not provide a subsidy? In other words, doesn't the strategic plan say right now that you will not provide a subsidy for the sale of low-income housing?
I believe it says that we're going to have a pilot program to test the existing mandatory 90-day right of first refusal. I don't think it says at this time there won't be any additional subsidies.
It bars subsidies at this time, though, does it?
At this time,
it does bar subsidies. Right. So I think Mr. Frank would have been interested in that. Mr. Chairman, I'll submit my other questions. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen, for your patience with us today.
I'll be very brief. I just want to raise one issue of concern that I've talked to Mr. Carney about privately, and that is that a number of us are very concerned that when you take over assets that they be disposed of in a way that the greatest number of bidders can appear on the scene, and often that means breaking up assets. In Washington, there is a kind of a natural syndrome that because we are big government, the people that approach big government are big parties. Coming from a congressional district in the middle of the country, it's quite clear to me that there are a lot of interested parties that may not be registering their concerns in Washington per se. And I would simply like to stress that when you take over large institutions, it would be my strong suspicion that there would be a maximization of value to the government in more than a few instances by breaking them up and offering them in competitive bidding to to a number of parties instead of as one specific whole. Now, I understand, as Mr. Carney's explained, that this occurred in Kansas and to the benefit of the government. And I would simply like to reiterate as strongly as I can that from my context with a large number of smaller institutions in the financial community, that there is a great deal of interest in assets if broken up, but there is no capacity to bring many smaller parties to bear with large institutions. This has some implications, although maybe only in a small way, to one of the concerns of Mr. Mpumi, and that is that if you only deal with large institution sales, you're dealing with a small panoply of those people that are rather well-heeled. And if we're going to get actors of a smaller nature, whether they be minorities or whether they be smaller institutions involved, we're going to have to think of small breakups. Now, I recognize this can be a little bit more of an administrative chore, but I suspect there'll be rewards in doing that. And again, I would only stress that from a congressional perspective, we have the greatest possible concern in bringing the greatest number of bidders to the scene, whether they be in actual home sales or institution sales themselves. And I just wanted to raise that, and John, if you have anything you want to respond, I'd...
But I think, Mr. Leach, we've tried to keep the bidding process as flexible as possible, and I think we've stated very clearly what the policy of the Oversight Board did, was just to spread our wings as far as possible in terms of creating as much of a knowledge base out there and as much information about properties that are up for sale as possible, and not constraining the profile of each bid. And we have, I think, specifically said in our testimony today that we encourage a variety of bids on a property, and that could go as well to breaking it up into smaller pieces as well as different profiles for a single bid.
Well, I appreciate that very much. And let me just say, as someone who is a great defender and respecter of the FDIC, the history of the FDIC is dealing with larger institutions or in a little more closed shop model than I think this particular asset disposition is. And so we're all learning in this process, and I think it's appropriate for the Oversight Board to stress as often as it can to institutions that are used to dealing in one constraint that it's a different world out there in a competitive bidding sense. Would you agree with that,
Absolutely.
Mr. Carney?
Absolutely.
Fine. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, I just want to correct for the record to Mr. Vento. My staff advises me that on the minority institution regulations and the minority contracting, the RTC board did defer action until we had a chance, we at the Oversight Board had a chance to promulgate a policy on those two issues, especially with respect to the financing of minority institution acquisition.
Any dates?
That was in late November, early December, something like that.
I've been informed that Mr. Robson necessarily has to be back in his office at Treasury by 3 o'clock. So we must understandably excuse him at this time. And thank you very much, Mr. Robson. We're very grateful to you. And unless, I'm sorry, Mr. Carper, Mr. Mpumi, but unless Mr. Kearney, who's still valiantly remaining here, is a target of a question, should we not excuse him too?
Yes.
Oh, you have a question? Well, all right, Mr. Kearney. Suppose if the decision is that both of you have questions, would we be able to complete this, say, by a quarter of three? Both.
Sure.
Members.
Whatever is your pleasure.
Is that suitable to you, sir? Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Carper?
Very briefly, Mr. Carney, thank you for your indulgence. I've read that the board has laid out three options for raising working capital. Federal financing bank, placement of some large deposits, broker deposits, gathering of those. A third would be through the Federal Home Loan Bank system. I've been chatting some with folks who are running Federal Home Loan Bank regional banks, and get a sense for whether there's been an influx of new members in those regional banks. We, you may recall, members of the committee, you may recall that we put in our legislation, we opened the door to membership to the home loan bank system to go beyond traditional SNLs, but to include other depository institutions who have some involvement in mortgage lending. In terms of that third option that the board has fleshed out, the Federal Home Loan Bank system, how realistic is that? Is there a lot of interest on the part of other depository institutions to join the system? Is that, are we seeing that kind of interest?
With respect,
how much money are we talking about being able to raise there?
Okay, I think that's a fair question. We have talked to the bank presidents, of which there is a finance committee of the bank presidents, headed by the president of the Atlanta Bank, Bob Schaffety, and we have had several meetings with his members of his committee and their counsel with respect to the use of the Federal Home Loan Bank advanced system. They are estimating, I believe this year, pay downs of about $15 billion. That is to say that they will receive paybacks on loans which will in turn retire debt of the system by about $15 billion, so that at least with respect to $15 billion, they feel like they have that capacity to provide loans. There are already about $15 billion of advances in the conservatorships at this point. I think that that is that's a realistic number. With respect to whether the Federal Home Loan Bank system has been able to attract non-thrift members, I'm not aware of what their experience has been.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Mpumi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Kearney, thank you also for sticking with us. We've been here for almost 5 hours, and I want to thank the chairman for pursuing this the way he has. I'd appreciate it if you would briefly share with this committee your philosophy and the philosophy of the RTC with regard to selling quickly to maximize recovery, as opposed to holding on to properties in an effort to minimize local impact. And if you choose the fire sale route, as many local real estate people fear, will it indeed maximize the government's recovery? And conversely, if that's not the case and you hold rigorously to the 95% rule and ignore the cost of holding properties while you wait for stronger markets, what should we expect a reasonable time frame to be as it relates to disposal and disposition? And will there occur a true recovery? I mean, will we recognize as a result, if we take that route, a better picture as opposed to quickly just disposing of these properties? I don't know if you've got a philosophy, but I hope the RTC has certainly thought about that and developed some position as to how it's going to proceed.
Well, I think that's a very good, that is a very key question, I think one of the roles of the Oversight Board is to establish the appropriate balance between disposition with alacrity and yet not too quickly that will depress markets. I think one thing that's important to remember here is that we're dealing with a known entity. I mean, we're not speculating as to what the wheat crop will be next year. These units are out there, they're in the community, and I, for one, would say that a vacant house across the street from an occupied house that is not being maintained is not only losing value in itself, it's causing houses all around that are being occupied by taxpayers to be impacted. So the quicker we can get those houses into the hands of the private sector and have people fixing them up, to my mind, all else being equal, that's
So you're going to be flexible with the 95%?
Yeah, and I, with respect to the 95%, the holding costs are included in the appraisal. That is to say, the appraiser is to include in his assessment of the value a reasonable holding period cost and at the Treasury rate.
And my time is just about expired, but are you dialoguing at all with local real estate interests who obviously have a great deal of interest in the disposition process?
I have met with appraisers as well as other real estate entrepreneurs and people involved in, especially in Texas, with respect to this issue several times, and recently as 2 weeks ago.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you once again,
Mr. Kearney. The committee will stand adjourned until tomorrow morning in this hearing room at 10 a.m.